Before we kick off the first panel discussion, I would like to call upon Mr. Kaviraj Singh to exchange a few views with you. Thank you, Kaviraj.
Good morning, everybody. I would like to say a few words about INBA. We are the only bar association in India that gives a membership to students, professors, practicing lawyers, in-house counsel. Even we have a chapter in 14 countries, foreign lawyers as well. Zameer has been associated with us since the beginning of INBA, and he has seen us grown each day. We are not just a conference organizer, and we are not here to make a profit. Most of our conferences are self-funded by our members. Either they pay delegate fees or sometimes they pay small sponsorships. So we are not a rich organization as such, but we are not a poor as well, because we are being sufficiently provided for by our own members. So it's INBA, we call it as a family. It's our first GC Summit in Mumbai. In Delhi, we have been celebrating our Law Day for the last 6 years. We have approximately 500 participants in New Delhi in our annual conference. And Zameer has seen it. The hotel people will ask us to vacate the premises, and they are not willing to vacate the premises. That's kind of an ambience, kind of a feeling we have. People come without asking. So I'm really proud of you all, and we are endeavoring to create a good base in Mumbai as well. The basic purpose of INBA, as I say, is not to organize a conference. What then is the purpose? Purpose is to be a torch bearer for a change. We are doing, and we have done already, a survey on sexual harassment, and that is being published almost every newspaper, almost every celebrity quoted by the every around the globe. This year particularly, we are emphasizing on women empowerment, for which we are organizing and publishing a book, handbook for a woman that has a law relating to divorce, succession, sexual harassment, and even a welfare scheme that's available to women entrepreneurs. So we are closely working with the government of India for a policy change as well. So each conference, we make a report, we record it, produce a report, and circulate among the stakeholder. So it's not a conference, it's a deliberation. And we welcome everybody to put forward their thoughts and what we can do as together, as a team, as a family, to make India a better place. For a GC summit, we have received a request from fellow GCs that their license is cancelled just because they are a GC, they are working in a company. So it means they are doing an illegal activity by rendering a legal OP to their company. And that is happening with the full knowledge to everyone. Recently, we have a judgment from the Gujarat High Court that says even a lawyer working full time in a law firm are not a lawyer anymore. It's pathetic. Even around the globe, judges are part of a bar association. GCs are part of a bar associations. Even a professor are part of a bar association. They are qualified lawyers because they are making a future lawyer. We say it's a very noble profession, and very big people in our profession, when they charge 20 lakh rupees per appearance or charge $400 per hour, they say it's a noble profession. I could not understand it. Why we are compelled to do a legal work by rendering a legal opinion by the GCs? So, I would like to have your comment on these topics. Hence, we can submit, and we have already discussed this with Ministry of Commerce. They are very receptive to these ideas, and they say, let us recognize GCs in the new era of our practice, where you are even don't require a law degree to become a lawyer. For a patent lawyer, you don't need a law degree. Am I right? I'm not an IP expert, but I do believe in that you need to have engineering degree. If you IT, if you are a software patent attorney. Chemical degree for chemical patents. So new practice area is developing. For this scenario, we need a different qualifications. It's not the only law minister prerogative or BCI to monitor, register these kind of lawyer GCs. Sometimes GCs are the company secretary. So we need a multidisciplinary authority that can regulate a law firm, that can regulate GCs and make it legal and recognize new emerging practice areas. And Ministry of Commerce is very receptive, and we would like to have your signature on the, and government will be very happy to make the changes in that process. They are very supporting to INBA. So I look forward to send us a comment directly or through Jamie to us. We as INBA always welcome everyone to, if you can do or contribute to the society by doing something pro bono. Everybody around the globe is proud. They write in their resume that they have mentored so many students, lawyers, budding lawyers. But in India, can ask the audience, how many you have mentored a young lawyer or student? Can you raise a hand if any of you has? I have a few hands. That's good. I see the beginning, but still a lot has to be done. It has to be recognized. A student or budding lawyer. Should not feel proud, but you should feel proud that you are doing something to change, bring a change in a society. And that has to be a mandatory part of resume before you select anyone to work for a company or a law firm. So you people have been our inspiration. And I thank you very much for coming and joining for this conference. And we are always and open to new suggestions to work toward the policy matters and to make India a better place to live in. Thank you very much.
Thanks indeed, Kaviraj sir, for setting the tone of the day. May I have Nidish speak a couple of words, please?
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Kaviraj, Zameer sitting on the dais. So while Kaviraj has basically touched upon what INBA's role has been in the last so many years and what he is focusing with the ministry, with the government, maybe on the pro bono side, for the GCs, in virtue of the Gujarat High Court judgment. I think it's been 9 years for me that I have been working with GCs around the country. Whether they are Indian promoted, large conglomerates, GCs, or whether foreign multinational GCs. I personally believe that a general counsel wears a lot of hats. It's not only about legal. I mean, a general counsel today, in today's time in India, has to interact with his business team, understand the problems, has to advise his MD or CEO of the company on day-to-day affairs, has to see each and every law. Law is very diversified. We all know that. You're drafting a contract, there's a cartelization which might affect, you have to see the arbitration clause. There's so many things that GC advisor they matter. They have to coordinate with the external consultants when there's a litigation. So I personally feel that GC in itself, when they run a team of 5 to 10 lawyers or 15 lawyers or 20 lawyers, it's a law firm in itself. More than a law firm. We as lawyers, we advise on M&A transactions or litigation. They have to see the business side of it. They have to think whether this litigation has a risk or not. I mean, whether filing this petition, am I going to gain out of it? The risk analysis is done by all these organizations, by all these GCs. And then they go back and report. So, keeping in mind, this GC summit was organized. That I personally believe and think the role of GC is equally important in today's time as that of a CFO or any other professional at the top level. So I hope that we all will be enriched and enlightened with all the rich experience of all the GCs sitting out here, more to join. And I wish all the luck to the conference and a great ahead. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Nidish. Nidish, as I said, is the chairman of the Western India region of INBA. And Nidish and Zameer have contributed immensely to the success of this conference. Zameer, you want to spend a few words, spend some time talking to the audience. Thank you.
Hi, good morning, everyone. First of all, when we planned this summit, we had seen a lot of events which were organized and we speak in all these events. The objectivity of this event was very clear to us that we will only take up burning topics, the real hot topics which are there. So for example, when you speak about fake news, when you speak about data protection, when you come to know about a study where, the Viagra, Pfizer case in China, where Viagra was launched in 1994 and finally in 2006, the Chinese court said rightfully Pfizer is the owner of the right in that particular medicine. It was too long for them to exercise the IP right because the generic companies had gone all out. When we speak about Nirav Modi case, you have fraud risk management. So we have information technology session, which is first, which speaks on the digital changes which are happening in the laws and the issue. Your Data Protection Act, which has come. You have fraud risk management, where Nirav Modi case was discussed. We have one of the panelists on Nirav Modi or fraud risk management panel. He's a banker, he's a managing director of a bank. And you know, he had predicted in one of the sessions a month back with me that, you know, this was a failure of maker and checker. And somebody from the audience said that this is basic. And the first PNB report on the investigation which has come says that there was a problem in the maker-checker system, which is how this person could exercise so much powers and the fraud could happen. In the intellectual property rights arena, we had an amendment in 2014 regarding the Copyright Act, where royalty was to be paid to the singers and musicians. According to my interpretation, and I think it should be the norm, every single actor will be entitled to the royalty. This will be in line with the foreign jurisdiction laws. And then we have discussions about Competition Act, which is coming up. As we speak more about Monsanto and the Bayer deal, which happened some time back, we had Flipkart and Walmart, which is there before the CCI. Yesterday itself, we saw that European Union has imposed 5 billion fine on Google for using their Android app in a manner which is not in the interest of the competition. So we took all these hot topics so that the real issues can be discussed. While we do this conference, you know, one of the best thing which happened when we did this first conference in Mumbai is that though we have been getting calls about people stuck in traffic, I want to applaud the audience that we expected a certain number and we have crossed that threshold by 30%. So we have 30% more crowd than what we had initially planned for. All right. So maybe this probably we may have to add some more tables. Another good news is that thanks to Kaviraj, Indian National Bar Association also provides you membership. So 1 year membership is free. The forms are available outside to all the audience who have been in this room today. That's a thank you very much, Kaviraj, to you. So while we go ahead with the topics which are there, these are the panels we are having. One is the laws and legal issues in the digital age, GC's role in fraud and risk management, intellectual property rights protection and implementation challenges, competition law in the modern disruptive world. All right. We have a star-studded panel in all the panels we have. The panelists are very experienced. They are very well known in the fraternity. Their opinion does matter in the long-term perspective. And that is how we have modeled the subtopics also in all the panels. I wish you to have a very great day and thank you very much.
Thanks, Zameer. So that was well rounded up by Zameer. So that's in a nutshell is the day's proceedings. And Zameer has very nicely taken you on a random walkthrough of what is going to happen today. So it's power-packed. It's really elite, and we look forward. We, in fact, encourage the audience to raise their hands, engage into question and answers. Insofar as we have a very, very watertight compartment, we are operating in that. So you can always take questions offline during the tea breaks and the lunch breaks. The first panel discussion on laws and legal issues in the digital age. Can we have the following dignitaries on stage, please? Mr. Zameer Nathani, Director, Legal, Raymond Limited. Zameer, we are going to see more of you on stage. You are going to keep pacing up and down the whole day, I promise you that. So that's Zameer on stage as the session moderator. So we'll be joining by Mr. Anubhav Kapoor, General Counsel and Company Secretary, Tata Technologies. Welcome, sir. Mr. Sachin Kalra, Head Legal and VP, Bharti AXA Life Insurance. Kiran Chitale. Mr. Chitale, sir. Yeah. Please welcome on stage Country Head Legal Operations and Technology at Barclays Global Services. Mr. Anirudh, Rastogi, Managing Partner, Corporate Law and Investments, TRA. We should take an opportunity of thanking our sponsors. TRA is one of them. Mr. Manish Kumar, General Counsel and VP Corporate Affairs at Zoomcar. Welcome, Manish. And Satvik, can we have Satvik on stage, please? Satvik Shekhar, Consultant Legal at Center for Trade and Investment Law, IIFT. This session will run close to an hour, and as I said, please do participate in these discussions. Whatever your queries may be, maybe it will just set off a spark today. So, Zameer, all over to you.
Thank you very much. So, yeah, as I promised you, we had selected the panel members based on the companies they are based in. So, we have covered Tata Technologies, we have covered Zoomcar, we have covered banking, Barclays, we have covered law firms, we have covered insurance industries, and we have representations from the government also. So the discussion today about laws and legal issues in digital age, since we had a very big panel and we had a lot of issues, because when you talk about today the digital world and the legal issues which are existing there, I can recall two examples where I've got an opportunity last year to visit the headquarters of Facebook and Apple. So when I visited Facebook last year, there was a legal team which made presentations to us. And you know, they had issues of fake news, which was becoming very common and famous. And therefore, there was some amount of pressure from the government on them. Like for example, they said in one of the presentation slides that the fake news has become a menace for them because there are certain fake news which come up for the government which is in power. And they had one country where the government had threatened to shut down Facebook operation, and therefore there were consequences which were very dire to them. In one jurisdiction, they had multiple litigations which were initiated by the government in power, and therefore it was difficult for the management of Facebook in that country to handle the issue. And therefore Facebook then started a policy to make this as a legal and compliance issue, and the legal department was then brought into picture to handle the digital issues which are now coming up in future. Okay, that was one side. The second side of the coin was that while this was getting into picture, and of course data protection regulation has come into effect now from the European Union, this was in the happening some time back, because we are friends in the EU, who were saying that at one point of time the government will really crack down in multiple countries. And the crackdown we saw was the first of Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook giving a testimony before the US Congress, some harsh questions which were put to him. The questions were, do you also take data of people who are not your Facebook members? And the answer was yes. And therefore, culminating out of all this, the European Union then finally decided on the data protection regulation, which requires a specific consent of the information provider for using the information for a particular purpose. All right? So the issue is rising. As we say that, you know, the damage is too much, and now there is a damage control mechanism which has been put in place, because you have a regulation in place, because there is a Facebook CEO giving a testimony to US Congress, and therefore now the companies have become very conscious and take this as a legal and compliance issue in their jurisdictions. All right. So this is the brief overview of the perspective with which we are now looking at digital laws and the issues which are arising in the companies. All right. So we divided our subject into these five following things. How do you look at compliance in a digital age? What about the privacy and cyber security? How is Indian legal system coping up to digital age? How are organizations coping up to the digital age? Because as a lawyer, as a legal team, as a legal head, as a legal team member, as a corporate law department, you are conscious when certain information is given to you or the certain information has to be shared. The other departments are not that conscious about it. So how organizations are now reacting to the digital age when it comes to compliance with the law? And then from the government side, when you speak about e-commerce, how the global trade WTO is going to deal with the issue, that perspective we are going to get from the representative of the Ministry of Commerce. And also one of the issues or the topic initiated with the government is that, do you need a unified body in India for issues relating to digital and the compliance under the law? So this is what we are going to present to you, all right? The first question on compliance in digital age to Anubhav, Tata Technologies. Anubhav, what will be the impact on corporate legal compliance and risk function in digital age? And will the cost increase with more technological advancement? With that, you can also answer, if possible, an inverse proportion, whether the cost will reduce when you have technological advances on legal compliances. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Zameer.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
The difficulty of having a lawyer as a moderator is you don't escape with easy questions.
Yeah.
So he's straight come to the point, I guess. Let me give you a straight answer as well, right? So if you reflect on the cost of compliance, let me start at the later part of the question then, and then move to the first part. So we're all probably dealing with compliance as one of our functions, and there are three basic elements that build up the compliance cost. The first is the people, the second is the process, the third is the tool, right? So each one of these elements add to the cost of compliance. And if you focus on all these three, and if you have all these three right, you'll have a good compliance program. Now let me step back a bit, right? Let me go, what is happening in each of these three areas? And if you reflect back, there are three things that we all are getting affected. One, the expectations of the stakeholders are changing. No longer I think the stakeholders are happy with numbers, the quarterly drives and number reporting or crunching, because they just can be shown in different ways which can create illusions. And I think the recent SEBI mandates for reporting, integrated reporting to top 500 companies is just a reflection of that. Stakeholders and shareholders are also interested now in the long-term health of the company. How much resources are you burning in terms of producing what you are producing, which basically means the whole reporting is changing, the expectations are changing, which also has a reflection on the kind of regulations you may expect in the future. And please don't be surprised, because we are moving to a consumption-based kind of society, users are becoming important, therefore you are seeing legislations like the data privacy across the world, you are seeing data. So that's one trend that is happening. Indirect taxes are becoming more important. The second one, I think, is this whole connected world concept, right? We are now moving, and it is faster than what we are thinking. We are moving to an IoT world. We are talking about Industry 4.0, which basically revolves around new business models. They are no longer asset-based models, but they are consumption-based models, right? No longer Boeing sells you jets which are based on the price of the engine, but the flying hours you clock on that engine is how they bill it. So the whole business models are changing. Ford is thinking of driverless cars, they are thinking of lease models, so and so forth. And the third, I think, important part that is changing is the whole machine-to-machine learning, which is the whole AI piece of it. And somebody asked me whether 20 years hence, lawyers will be there. He answered me, yes, machines will take over most of what lawyers do now, but lawyers will evolve into something different. They have to skill themselves differently. And that leads me to the first remark that was made by, as an opening consent, that keep doing, uncertainty of law is the strength of lawyers, because that is what machines cannot do. Thank you.
Yeah. So IBM Watson, if you have heard about, has introduced a software which provides you legal opinions to an extent in compliance with the law. Anubhav, just want to ask you, in your corporate, in Tata Technologies, when you speak about compliances, have you adopted digital technologies for compliances, or is it manual or?
No, big time. I don't think with the span we have, 16, 17 countries of compliances, it is not possible humanly for us to kind of, one, know the laws of all the countries, and second, to manage businesses. So I think we are big time into automation and digitalization, and on top of it, we are also now getting into a regime where we think analytics can be part of compliance, where we can make decision making before the law comes, right? How is it going to kind of affect? Because more and more governments are now publishing draft legislations, giving the breathing space to the people to kind of react on the compliances, and also giving time for the corporates to think about how it, they have to change to meet those compliances. So it is, we are not talking only about like putting some software tools there, but we are now thinking even on the analytics part of it.
I think analytics is a good tool. I mean, we never thought about on the legal compliance part. I think that will give us futuristically in a legal compliance, analytics will play a role. Manish, managing compliance in the digital age, Zoom car, do you comply and do you implement softwares?
So thank you, Zameer. So I'll just start with the statement where Anubhav has ended up saying that this tool, so he has pointed out 3 points, saying that for the compliance, like people, process and tool. So the basic question is, why only tool? So if you look at the compliances which has been managed by all these professionals 10 years or 8 years ago, so I do remember we were supposed to do all these things through the checklist being maintained into Excel sheet or whatever we are doing through offline and all. So after this Companies Act 2013, and if I'll just do the comparison of section 217, the earlier director's report, and 134 of the new Companies Act director's report. So director's report, subsection 5, itself says that all the directors are required to ensure that the company is having one system and that system is working properly and it's adequate. Now, if you look at the historical program, people were just hiring the company secretary or lawyers who were supposed to do the compliances. Now, as per the legal requirement, it is not efficient enough just to hire a person. You will have to ensure that there is a system which is working and that system is adequate, which is going to work upon on behalf of the company. So this is the genesis why the tool is being mandated through the act itself. Now the question is how this tool is going to work upon. So I do understand there is like all traditional companies or big multinational companies where anybody can go and ask from the management that I need this kind of funds to install this system in the company. Since I have spent like 7-8 years into the startup culture, it's truly important to convince the management, because the management which is having the experience of 5 years or 6 years maximum and who are coming from the institutions like IIT and IIM, they're mostly focused about the business and business. So while we're going to integrate the tool, it's pretty important to get the management perspective. What is the thought process of management? Because management is not going to allow you to install one tool which is just inclined towards the some kind of reporting and compliances. So at that point in time, we are supposed to show them how it is going to help, what are the benefits which is going to accrue to the company. And I'm not going to talk upon the behalf of the companies like Raymond and Tata. Recently, I'll be talking about the companies which are into the startup culture. And they're mostly concerned about the fundraise. And while I'm talking about fundraise, the second thing which comes into picture is how I'm going to do or perform during the due diligence.
Exactly. So, you know, that is the perspective, because in Reliance ADAG, we had the concept of startup. And, you know, at that point of time, as you rightly pointed out, it's all about business. So when it's all about business, you know, your compliances, your one-sided indemnity clause, etc., those are less considered. But point is that when it comes to fundraising, it's a very shocker when the investor says, that whether in the due diligence he finds that there are agreements where, you know, certain clauses are not acceptable and therefore the investment does not materialize on those grounds because the company is a less compliant company comparatively.
Yeah.
So that's
yeah. So now
that's a good suggestion and a threat you give to your management.
Yeah. So now, so while I'm talking about the tool, it's not only restricted to the compliance. So now we are extending it to the contract management, litigation management. As Zameer has rightly said, that even if I'm going to talk upon the contract management, so if my contract is expiring on a certain date, so somebody has to go and control when it is going to expire, whether there is a termination requirement, when my EOD is triggering, what are the consequences of EOD. So the moment I'm going to have all these abstract into the tool, this tool would be giving me the information how to react upon those things. So that's okay. Why we are going to install all these tools into the system.
Okay. So Practice League will give us suggestion how to ensure flawless implementation. Yes. Sarabji? Ali, he's not joined.
I'll just answer on behalf of Sargit here. Because I had taken the help from the Practice League into installation of all these tools over there. It's not only Practice League, I do not want to name the tools which are available into the market. There are so many tools. Definitely Practice League is one of them and they are doing really great. So while they are going to integrate all these tools, they are providing these tools along with the API integrations with the company's database, how the data is being captured into the system. So I'll just give you one example of my company. So we are having these details of the customers who are booking the cars, how they are going to drive the cars, all these data we are capturing over there. So the moment there is any fraud which is coming to picture or there is any litigation coming to picture, what we are supposed to do, like we are operating into 29 cities. It's pretty tough. It's real pain in the neck of a lawyer to go and handle all these data from one place and then go and convince the people sitting into like one distant place, one SHO into one like police station. While we had integrated this Practice League through our system, now the person sitting into one distant place who is working on behalf of Junkar legal team, they can have this API integrations through this server of Junkar with the Practice League and then they can fetch the data at that point in time. The best part of these tools are that they are having this app-based program also. So suppose the SHO is asking that who is the person, how can you show me that this DL which you are producing in a soft copy or hard copy is correct or not. So the moment I'm going to log in into the data through the app, I can show the DL program or whatever this ID proof of this person who has done the fraud with the company. So these are the ways how these tools are categorically helping the company, the new age company, into this database.
So coming to Kiran, when he speaks about this point, in Barclays, you have physical documents, digital documents, or both? And how do you control the confidentiality of those in the digital age right now?
Okay, So one is, of course, the company I deal with or work with, it's more of a captive, and therefore we don't have much of litigation here, frankly speaking. So in that sense, we keep most of the data in the electronic format. And obviously, it has access restrictions in terms of maintaining the confidentiality. And that is where it helps meaning the internal stakeholders. So we have our internal shared folders or internal access mechanism where the access to the information, even within legal department, is meaning with access rights or access with access restrictions on for it. And that's how we make sure that the confidentiality is maintained. And for physical documentation, of course, we have a categorization. We make sure that the documents that are non-confidential, we deal with those separately. The documents that are confidential are treated properly and, you know, are not, meaning there is a clean desk policy and stuff like that, which is almost everywhere.
Oh,
so
yes.
I'm not talking just about Barclays, frankly. It's like generalizing in terms of how most of the corporates nowadays deal with the data. And it's all about being aware about it, being bit more professional about it, being more matured about this subject as a confidentiality, meaning from that lens. But certainly physical documents, I feel it's a bit difficult where you have to have movement of the papers, file those properly, take those to the courts if you need to and those kind of things, or to the law firms. For
so is it a
device.
Compliance norm in Barclays?
Yeah, it is.
On all these?
No, it is part of our compliance requirement or a policy requirement where how you deal with the data, how you deal with the information and how do you classify information is all defined. And that's the norm.
You have a policy in place.
We have a policy that deals with the information classification and treatment.
Analytics and policies on digital age. Okay.
Can I add
yes,
two
please.
Points?
Yes.
Just adding to what Kiran and added, tools are important part because they are enablers, right? And so that's a starting point to have it. And what we are basically seeing is that if you implement the tool properly, this means it's a reflection of your processes as well. It also helps you train people. When you are working in organizations where people are moving from one function to other functions or one region to other, tools are basically your constraints, right? So there is basically compliance by design. That's what tools enable you.
And you are implementing this in 16 countries.
Yeah, more than that.
More than that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. And the second point is, in terms of the audit, see, tools itself may not be the answer to your compliance needs, because I think audits also have to be done, and that is where I think the internal compliance teams should now start getting trained on that and come up to those expectations. Traditionally, many companies, the internal audits have been doing the compliance audits as well. I don't feel the internal audits are designed to do compliance audits. Compliance audits have different formats, and they kind of what we do is in terms of three stages: the diagnostic, the framework audits, and the transaction audits. The diagnostic audits basically help you to identify the gap. The transaction audits really get into the physical documents of it, and the framework audits kind of match your processes with the compliances, right? So it's a different approach altogether that helps you really get to the analytics part of it, or where you can take decision making based on that.
Okay.
I just wanted to add that.
No, fantastic. Just one request to you is that whatever you have spoken on the audit part, I see as a future. If you can make a one-pager note which we can circulate to everyone. Because it's good. It's futuristic what you're talking about. And it's multi-country wide. So it is a next stage we are looking into digital compliance.
We're doing it for last 3 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. One-pager note for all of us. Okay. On the compliance and digital age, this was the first part of it. We now move to the second part on the privacy and cyber security. Okay. Much has been spoken about privacy and cyber security because of the data leak, because the Facebook issue became so famous. There was a testimony of Mark Zuckerberg in US and one more country added to it. Issues regarding Twitter, the government of India asking Twitter to control certain newses because, you know, it creates violence, etc. You had data protection regulation which has been implemented by the EU requiring specific consent of the person providing information. Well, when you read this in the newspaper, you get information and you are charged regarding the information. But the real problem which comes is to the corporate, and then it boils down to the legal department, where the legal department is mandated to ensure that we are in compliance with all these regulations. We don't want to be on the wrong side of the law and get highlighted in the newspapers. So the lawyers sitting in the room are basically responsible for execution under the instructions. Now, when we go to this topic, my first question to Anirudh, TRA law, is that there are certain areas where you don't have regulations, like you speak about blockchains, like you speak about drones. So there are companies which are manufacturing drones. Point is that government has come out with some basic regulations in that. There is no specific law in that. You have rental e-commerce. We have heard about e-commerce. There is a rental e-commerce concept also. There are financial technology companies which are coming up. Now, how do you deploy new technology-led business models when there is a non-existence of a regulatory framework? And, you know, how do you control them, because there is no regulatory clarity given to you by the government, and you don't want to be on the wrong side of the law when you're initiating this? So how do you deploy all these new technology-led business models when there is no regulatory framework available, like blockchains and drones, example?
Thank you, Zameer. I think you've set the context very well and make my job a little easier.
Okay. So
I think what I'm going to speak about applies as much to navigating the emerging, evolving privacy framework as it does to generally any new business model or new technology, as some of the examples that you gave. Right? And something that Zameer and Anubhav also mentioned a little bit about is the expanding role of lawyers in the digital world, where new business models, where typically, traditionally, the largest hotel companies today don't own hotels, like the largest cab companies don't own cabs, right? So when conventional business is now getting disrupted and being done, and there's a tectonic shift there, how does lawyers, I believe, cannot continue to just wear the hat of a lawyer, but they need to also evolve a policy mindset. And I say that because when you're thinking about risk mitigation, your risk mitigation is obviously always premised on the laws as they exist today, not on laws as they are likely to evolve 2 years and 3 years hence, right? And therefore, something which Anubhav said about analytics, it is very important for you to have your radar working and keep a tab on what are the conversations happening behind closed doors, what are the conversations happening generally among stakeholders, which are going to have implications on first the legal framework and then on my business, right? Second is, once you have these insights, how do you prepare yourself for these? And third, how do you have your own narrative heard and become a part of this conversation? Right? So, I would like to give a couple of examples, but I think it's very important, firstly, to be engaging with the relevant stakeholders. And when I say that, it's easier said than done, because I would like to just take and dwell upon our own experience in the blockchain industry or the drones industry. Many a times you will not realize how many stakeholders there really are at play, right? So the unmanned aviation or drones industry, for instance, is not just the domain of the Ministry of Civil Aviation and the DGCA, which is the regulator, but as much the domain of the Ministry of Home Affairs, because there are security concerns over the use of drones. It is as much the concern of the Ministry of Defense and the Cree forces, because they also share the air zones with the commercial with the commercial airliners or other, anybody who wants to use the airspace needs to share it with the defense, right? Then there is the Wireless Planning Commission, because you ultimately, when you're remotely flying an unmanned aircraft, you're using a certain spectrum to communicate with the drones. So that's the Wireless Planning Commission which comes into the play.
So what is this authority? Wireless Planning Commission.
Under the DOT.
Under the?
The DOT, the Department of Telecommunication.
Okay.
So literally I can map out about 20 stakeholders just in the unmanned aviation space, not to mention the various associations, industry associations, where the domestic association is at conflict with the international association, and then there's the Israeli association, because Israel is at the forefront of drone technology, and then Chinese, because they're the largest manufacturers of commercial drones. So there's literally more than 20 stakeholders which you can map. And these are departments and associations and organizations, not to mention the individuals who run these departments, right? So you need to literally map out every single stakeholder and begin to anticipate what interests are at play. Where is it that I need to collect insights from, and how can I become a part of those conversations? Just one other thing I would like to mention is, and maybe coming closer to the topic on privacy, for example, privacy and then data localization, which is becoming increasingly a hot topic for discussion as of now. Now, many a times what happens is, why it becomes so important to have a narrative heard, is that the policy making is not always informed by all narratives which should be, which should be heard. So very clearly, data localization, for example, there was a huge talk 6 months back about how big tech, which literally has a monopoly on data, right? I mean, collecting a tremendous amount of data over tens of years. That's at odds with startups, our domestic startups. And why don't we create a sandbox where big tech companies are then compelled to contribute data so that it can be used by all other domestic players in the country as well? Now, honestly, if you were to reach out to the other stakeholder that is meant to be appeased by the government, startups don't necessarily really want it. Okay, and only when you do that, it's only when you bring that narrative out is when it's important to then. That's why I say it's important to map out the stakeholders, figure out do they really care, and get your narrative out. So this is what, I mean, broadly I wanted to say on analytics and policy, that lawyers need to kind of expand their role and think ahead 2 years, 3 years, or 5 years hence, then look at risk mitigation strategies.
So sum in substance, engage with the stakeholders when it's a non-regulatory environment on a particular business model. All right. Sachin, question to you is that how insurance sector is now coping up to GDPR? Did your company also send an email to everyone saying that if you don't want, let us know? So, and how do you see Indian regulators also, ensuring privacy of the policy holders?
Thanks, Zameer. So, first of all, coming to the point, whether we are sending it, as an insurance company, there's a proposal form which is already for the consent is being taken of the customer that we can use this for the services provided by the company towards the insurance policy.
Oh, you take
by default, this is by default, which is the picture which is built in at the time of technical.
That's the problem with the legal department, that they put the check marks.
So coming to the GDPR side of that, whether it's applicable to Indian industry of insurance industry, first of all, we need to learn what is GDPR basically we are.
Yes.
So GDPR, which is the legislation, is passed in Europe basically. So what GDPR says, it's a protection of natural persons, data, processing of personal data. Processing means it can be collection of data, it's going to be transaction of data, it's going to be servicing of data. So how to protect the data basically within the territory of Europe basically.
Correct.
So this GDPR is a location based basically.
Correct.
And it's not a sector specific.
Correct.
It's a location based, and which says that goods and services provided in the state of Europe.
Correct.
To the person who is in Europe. It's not a citizenship based.
Correct.
Any person who is in Europe, this data cannot flow over years.
Any connection with the data which has implication on the EU, either a person or a business.
So coming back, it's a location based. So hence, if Indian company, Indian insurance industry doesn't provide any services to the Europe's customer.
Okay.
They give policies in Indian as per Indian laws. So hence, it's not applicable to the insurance industry basically.
Okay.
If you say, but in case if we go and say that this sell it in Europe and with the currency of Europe is there, or in the state of Europe only, then it will be applicable to the insurance.
But in your company, does it have that implication right now on GDPR?
No, it's not applicable.
It's not. It's not. But are you then engaging with the commission which has been formed under Justice Sri Krishna? I had an opportunity to discuss this with Justice Sri Krishna. We were speaking at a panel and an opportunity to drop in home. And I asked him about this data protection. And he is thinking on the same lines of EU. But there is a net neutrality which has now been declared by the government, and Justice Sri Krishna's commission is working on the Data Privacy Act. Our suggestion would be to engage with them so that that implication may also be in India tomorrow and applicable to your sector.
So for us as an insurance industry, as I told very early, we have a life council and then the IRDA regulator is there.
Right.
Who is directly engaging with the ministry and with the Justice Sri Krishna.
Okay.
Wherein data privacy is the first step of IRDA also.
Okay.
We have been issued, the CISO regulations are there, cyber security regulations are there.
Okay.
CISO person has been appointed who does an audit for every function every month.
Okay.
And he is the person who is controlling all data outside inside the company also.
Okay.
So basically we are dealing with the personal data of a customer. Every name, place, age, everything is available with us. So to safeguard this, insurance and IRDA also has come with a picture that you should have a repository.
Okay.
And every company is working towards the tool to have an online policy, immediate policy that we discussed earlier. So real-time data available. So real-time data can be available by the tools only. And everything is available online. That's the best part for the industry also.
Okay.
Apart from that, IRDA also come with the Aadhaar-based layers that you should have Aadhaar-based policies only. And every company started getting an Aadhaar updation. No matter what the UID is going on to with the struggle of Supreme Court and apart from those ministries.
Okay. So with that, while we talk about data privacy, etc., artificial intelligence and all that, these questions will come later to the panel. One thing where the government is also engaged with the World Trade Organization is that, the impact of global trade negotiations, specifically the proposed e-commerce negotiations at the World Trade Organizations in the digital sector, which is happening for India. We have Ministry of Commerce, Satwik, who's going to throw light on that. What will be the impact on these negotiations while you go into this digital space, where you go into the digital issues and legal compliances? how negotiations of the government of India are proceeding in WTO.
Thank you, Mr. Nathani. So I'm here to really give a government's perspective and a policymaker's perspective on these issues. Yeah. First of all, before I come to this issue, I'd like to just go back to the issue of stakeholders' consultation, which Anirudh talked about. It is true that the government finds it really difficult to bring stakeholders under the same roof and discuss about the prospective policies which we want to come out with. There are a lot of stakeholders, so we might be sitting in Delhi, Bombay, or the other metropolitan cities. We are well aware about, we are politically aware, we are policy-wise aware as well. But if you move to tier 2, tier 3 manufacturers or MSME people, they don't really know the repercussions of their own work. If you go to them as the government's representative and tell them that we want to come out with a certain policy which might affect your functioning and we want your inputs on it, they're not really ready to come to the government and actively get involved in stakeholders' consultation. So that is where I think it will be good if the lawyers and the general counsels really help their own companies understand the value of stakeholders' consultations. It's a genuine plea from the government side that it would be really helpful for us to have more and more stakeholders on board while thinking about policies. Because if we come out with a policy and if it does not really cater to the interests and needs of a particular section of the stakeholders, the government faces the flak. It comes in the media, and there are a lot of bad press happening against the government. So I'm not saying the government is doing everything right. I'm not saying that. We try our best. So if we are trying our best to bring stakeholders' viewpoints in the policy making, I think it would also be good if the stakeholders also on their own come to the government and show them, because they are working at the grassroots level, at the ground level. They are experts in their fields, whether it's finance, whether it's management, whether it's if it's a mining industry, the intricacies of metallurgy. Government doesn't really know these things. We need specialist representations from the stakeholders. So that is one thing where I think the general counsels can really help us improve the bridge between government and stakeholders. And secondly, Mr. Sachin talked about Bharti Act maintaining data of all the employees which you have. I think that's a very good thing, and the government is actually thinking about possibilities of having a centralized database where real-time data is being uploaded and accessed by all the stakeholders, private entities or other entities. Where suppose if an employee of Bharti AXA quits the firm and wants to join another company, and if a company wants to hire a person with the same skill set, they can actually go and get themselves registered with that database and look at the employment history of that employee and can have the feedback from Bharti AXA. So I think that is something where we want to streamline the process of making the right people with the right skill sets available to the right companies who need that skill set. Because right now there's a lot of disconnect between the skill set which the employees have and the skill set which the employers want them to have. So that is something, again, the government is looking to that. So I think what Bharti AXA is doing is wonderful, and we can have more and more stakeholders and we can have that at a more bigger level. So that could be helpful.
Now, so two things which I figure out on the, one is on the WTO side, the government is having an open door saying that, you know, we would like to engage with the stakeholders, as pointed out by him, as pointed out by TRA law also, that there is a non-regulated area. So engage with the stakeholders. Government would also like to get them engaged with the stakeholders. One thing which I found very good about Ministry of Commerce, I would like to give a compliment, because with Sudhanshu Ji, Justice Shri Krishna, I was on a panel. Ministry of Commerce, as you say, I mean, Ministry of Law is of course there. Ministry of Commerce has been very open to all these stakeholder suggestions and all that, because, you know, in the interest of commerce, it's going ahead. So when you talk about WTO negotiations, Ministry of Commerce has a red carpet for the stakeholders to come and give suggestions so that they can see through all these things before the WTO. I remember very clearly when Mr. Sudhanshu Ji was there with me, he was discussing about a Singapore policy where law firms are financed by the government to open branches abroad so that they can have business and the dollars can flow in. All right. So today, the government of India, Ministry of Commerce, has a red carpet for the shareholders, for the stakeholders who want to give suggestions in the WTO and join with them. So as I speak, Satvik has a senior by the name James. He's in Washington and negotiating on all these factors. Unfortunately, he's landing a day after, otherwise he would have been on our panel. So government has been very receptive on WTO when this e-commerce and startup companies are coming up, and to the digital issues and laws which are coming up on negotiations at a WTO level. All right, that's a good suggestion. Coming down from international to national again, Sachin, how is our Indian legal system basically coping up to the digital age?
Thanks, sir. See, judiciary basically is adopting to the the system which is
today. If you see the High Court website, they are able to give you data.
All data is available.
Cases which are filed and cases which are heard.
It is all subject to that only. This is only which we are saying that the metro cities which is developing on the part. Apart from that, if you go to rural side, although as per the government of India, 2005 the scheme started that every person or every court will be computerized, they will be linked to NGSS. We have orders available on, nets available, e-court is there, then we have component is there, all those things which are there for getting data.
Right.
Filing is the basic thing which is required.
Oh yes, I agree filing. With you.
E-filing is the basic thing to get into the role that yes, my cases will reduce soon, except Delhi High Court or Hyderabad which has been in picture. Been e-filing been done there, and e-filing there no need to file off documents there. Time will come, but presently if we say the matters are reducing, because why is not reducing? Because the administration which is there backside, they are not well equipped. Well learning is not there. Unless until they are learned, they have been trained properly, the size will not go down. As such, which we say more than 3 crores of cases are pending on all over courts in India. So get it reduced as per the justices only, it says it will take 350 years or to reduce these cases.
So how to reduce? So we had given some 3 suggestions to the government. We had given around 8 suggestions. 3 examples is that we had suggested to the government that, you know, when you have cases which are coming up and you need to serve a paper copy of it, why not instead the lawyer serves to another lawyer an email copy of that? And when you're arguing a matter, why not use an iPad or a laptop so that, you know, I can avoid the paper? Number 2, we had suggested to the government that summons can be served by email. We were not very fan of WhatsApp at that point of time. So this was one of the suggestions. The 3rd suggestion we had given to the government is that, you know, to travel to the courts and all that, the litigants have little inconvenience. So in certain matters, if we can have Skype courts which are there in some parts of the world. So these are some of the suggestions we have given to the government. And we really want the government to
accepting that, Delhi High Court has come with Tata assessment of what's accepting summons on WhatsApp.
Oh yes.
And the Sonipat cases there where the evidence has been done online, only video conferencing.
Yes, yes.
That's going on, that's creating on, but the training needs to be done up to the level of rural area where the India is basically, where the cases are pending on the law.
Okay. Kiran, do you see the judiciary moving with the digital aid technologies?
I think the co-panelist answered most of the points here, and yeah. In the interest of time, I'll just say that probably the same thought process, including the suggestions that you mentioned being made to the government, can be extended further. Today we have to book a cab, we get a SMS saying, you know, or a message saying that this cab driver and the car details. If we can also say, because I see that more on the practicing side, where the lawyers have to go to the court and the case will come up probably in the second part of the day, and everyone spends time just to be around, and you know, it's more of professional, I would say, waste of time. In that sense, if the case, for example, I'm a lawyer who is an individual and just practicing there, I got just one case today in the court, I don't have to spend the whole day there. I don't need to. And therefore, probably if I get a message, probably your case is coming up, this is at number 26 and at 4 o'clock tentative time, but at least in that range of the time slot, it saves my time. So I'm just kind of extending the same thought with an example by saying that this level of digitization will take time, obviously, as he mentioned. Probably things are on right track, and the suggestions that you mentioned are quite fair.
That's part of one of our suggestions, because yes. In the American system, you have 20 minutes to argue on each side. And then subject to extension which has been given. So that is one
exactly.
of the suggestions.
If something digitalized, online judgments are there,
yeah.
Presidents available, the case laws can be put in the presidents only, and the judgment can come immediately also.
Correct. Absolutely. But then you see that change now happening, because I had an experience in a lower court in Maharashtra where the judgment was uploaded at 6 o'clock in the evening because they said we have a mandate now to upload the judgment on the same day. So, you know, that's the kind. So I think judiciary is moving towards that. All right. So on the Indian legal system side, so we have discussed about compliance in the digital age. We have discussed about privacy and data protection. We have discussed about the WTO approach. We have discussed about the Indian legal system. One of the important things, you know, see, these are all future perspective things you will hear in the news and otherwise in the trade, is that WTO GATT services, the impact of the e-commerce services being recognized under World Trade Organization GATS, and what will happen vis-a-vis the free trade agreement India has. Today we have an information technology session. There's an e-commerce recognition by the WTO GATT system. There are certain free trade agreements we have got where, you know, there are no systems or processes we have to comply with the WTO. It's a free trade happening between two countries like India and Canada. But once it comes under the umbrella of the WTO, what impact it will have on the free trade agreements in with India and other country, Ministry of Commerce, Satvik.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Nathani. Yeah, so the 11th ministerial conference of the WTO happened in November last year, and there was a proposal from the developed countries that we need to have a multilateral agreement on e-commerce. And there were certain elements which were proposed by the developed countries. US had proposals, Japan had, Brazil had, EU had. India faced a lot of flack. Why? Because we really stopped these negotiations, and we were called anti-liberalization, we were called anti-trade. But the fact of the matter is that India has not yet reached the technological advancement level compared to the Western world. So in trade jargon, we call global north and global south. Global north are the developed countries which are technologically advanced. Their service providers are capital rich. And we are global south, the developing countries. We are resource rich. So they invest in our country. But when they invest in our country, so we have all the US-based, Silicon Valley-based technological companies providing their services in India, they're doing that. But despite that, India has been able to recently come out with policies like Digital India, Make in India, Smart Cities, etc. Why, even RuPay for that matter. Why have we been able to do that? Because at the WTO level, and even at the bilateral treaty level, India has managed to retain a policy space to promote its domestic entities. If we were not in a position to do that, there is a massive threat from the MNCs who would come to India with their services and would really squeeze the domestic producers, if not the bigger ones, but at least the MSMEs for sure. I'll give you an example. At the WTO level, there is an agreement called Information Technology Agreement. Now, the first version of Information Technology Agreement required all the countries to impose zero tariff on hardware. So you use keyboards, you use laptops, you use motherboards in the CPUs, etc. Now, when these are manufactured outside India, Japan, China, Southeast Asia, US, wherever, when they're imported to India, there's no import duty. That is why they're able to sell at a considerable cost in India, because they don't have to pay the tax to the government for exporting to India. But that might sound really good, that the consumers are getting cheap products. But on the flip side, can we really name one Indian manufacturer of hardware presently competing with Hewlett-Packard or competing with the Amcat or Eyeball? We cannot, because they were squeezed out, they're phased out. So we have to understand that Indian domestic industry, fortunately or unfortunately, is not yet at the level where it can absorb the international competition. That is why India needs to really stop further liberalization, because the developed countries, it's very important to understand that the developed countries and the service providers from those developed countries have taken the benefit of, they have the first mover's advantage. they when digital reforms happened in Silicon Valley, they formulated their policies which were massively in favor of these individual service providers, and due to technological advancements, they could really spread their wings across Latin America, Africa, Southeast Asia, Asia, and all the entire developing countries. And we as developing countries did not really get time to respond or react to such a digital explosion which happened in the West. But now when we actually realize that we also need to have a say at the WTO level, where we also need to reach that technological advancement level and reduce the digital gap. Until unless that does not happen, it is compulsory to protect the domestic service providers and domestic manufacturers by having policy requirements like data localization, server localization, or local content requirement, or having a requirement of investing in India through a joint venture or similar legal entities. So we need to do that. These might be regarded as trade restrictive, but that is fine. 100% trade liberalization has never been the purpose of the WTO, because 100% liberalization would mean you are damaging your own industry and you are actually kind of selling your policy space to a bunch of multinational state companies who have a massive lobby at the WTO level. I'll give a very small example. One of the US proposals was with respect to, I'll very quickly sum up. One of the US proposals was with respect to electronic authentication. We all make card payments online when we purchase things on electronic platforms. And electronic authentications are to protect our transactions, OTPs, net banking passwords. So these are different factors, right? Now, a US proposal in a very flowery language said that electronic authentication is important. Electronic signature protects our privacy. It is important to respect the sensitive data of individuals and all. It was all very good, but the last line, which was the most important line, said that the prospective multilateral rules shall ensure that service providers should decide the method of electronic authentication. Now we all use cards, visas. I think like with the accuracy of 100%, I can say all of us have a Visa or a MasterCard. I doubt maybe one in a thousand might have a rupee or a card which is not a Visa or MasterCard. Now imagine if Visa and MasterCard end up deciding how to protect your sensitive data, which might go against the government's policy or even the consumer's interest. They are sitting in US, they have a database spread all across the country, all across the world for that matter. If they end up deciding how to protect your sensitive data, how to protect the privacy of an Indian national, I think that is a red flag. We do not want that to happen. We do not want our sensitive data to be protected by and in a manner decided by the stakeholders, the foreign stakeholders. That is why we have started having these policies of data localization, server localization, to really keep the sensitive data of Indian nationals within the boundaries of India, so that it's easily accessible and this data can actually help bridge the end users, the stakeholders, as well as the government to formulate new laws.
Yeah, data localization I think is a good thought. We have just half a minute to finish this particular session. Quick review on from Anubhav. What changes you observe within your organization with this technological changes which are happening on the legality side? And then one inside question I need to ask Ministry of Commerce on a unified body which they are planning to form. Okay. Yeah, Anubhav, quickly.
So I think to keep it short, I think quite a few changes. I think we are reimagining a lot of our processes. But from a legal point of view, I think while we in the past we used to see legal compliance risk as separate functions, now we see an increased convergence of the GRC using tools and more of processes to integrate that for decision making.
Okay. We have different regulators, we have different policies on e-commerce. Are you planning for a unified regulatory body for India?
Well, that's right. We have TRAI for telecom related and DTH related issues. We have a CCI for competition issues. We have
But are you planning to have a unified one?
Yes, we were really happy to. So we had conducted stakeholder consultations a couple of weeks ago on electronic, because the Ministry of Commerce is planning to have a national framework of on electronic commerce in a few months' time. So we were really happy to see that all the issues which really came up, which the stakeholders really to inform the government that we are facing X, Y, Z of issues. The one common agenda on everyone's thought was that we need to have a regulatory body which is independent from competition issues, which is independent from consumer protection issues, which is independent from taxation issues, because these are all scattered across different legislations, across different ministries and departments, and across different regulations, regulators as well. So we are planning to have a independent regulator for e-commerce, but it's at a very nascent stage right now. So
okay.
I can't really.
So all stakeholders interested in giving suggestions to the government, government is presently inviting suggestions on a unified regulatory body in e-commerce and the digital space we have. So we discussed about compliance in digital age, privacy and data protection. We had Indian legal system coming up. We had TO approach, which is there, and impact of the same in the organizations of the digital issues which are happening presently, and the government thought about a unified regulatory body which is work in progress. Suggestions from stakeholders are invited. Thank you very much. We had a big elite panel. Thank you very much to all the audience for the patience listening. Thank you very much again.
Thanks indeed, Zameer and your wonderful team members. I request Zameer to hand over small mementos on behalf of INBA. As a token of appreciation, Zameer can start with Satvik. Thank you, Satvik. Can I call Divya on stage, please? Divya from Ebex. Divya would want to hand over a memento to Zameer. So you too deserve a token of appreciation from us. It's the least we can do. Thank you, Divya. Thank you, Zameer. Thank you, Divya. Yeah, this side. Aap is taraf aajaiye, shirof.
Thank you very much.
So that was a wonderful session to kickstart the discussions. I'll quickly call the next panel on stage for want of time. We started a little late in the morning, and thank you very much for your forbearance, ladies and gentlemen. I will request the panelists of the group discussion on GC's role in fraud risk and management and compliance. Moderator, Mr. Ambar Gupta. Ambar, can be high on stage, please. Head legal and compliance, Birla Sun Life Insurance. To be joined in by his fellow panelists, Ms. Divya Kumat, Executive Vice President and Chief Legal Officer and Company Secretary of Datamatics Global Services. Divya, can we have you on stage, please? Ms. Sandhya Vishal, Chief Counsel and Ombudsman at South Asian or Nielsen. Thank you, Sandhya. Mr. Tushar Chawla, General Counsel and Ethics Officer, JLL Group. Thank you, Mr. Chawla. Mr. Hemant Kumar, Group General Counsel at Larsen & Toubro. Thank you, Hemant sir, for joining us. And Mr. Mohit Shukla, Managing Director and Legal Head at Barclays India. Thank you, Shukla sir, for joining us on stage. Once Divya is around, I'll usher her on stage, but I think Ambar should start. Thank you. I'll just take a minute before Ambar starts. We have our friends at Practice League and Lira Enterprises at the farther end of the hall, and they are seated there. They would like to say hi to you, and they would like to tell you what their products and services are. So during the breaks, please take some time off to network with them too. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome all the panelists for this topic on GC's role on fraud risk management. As you all know, that fraud risk has gained a lot of importance over the last couple of years, especially after the online frauds, data theft frauds. And there are various non-traditional methods of fraud has emerged over a period of time. In fact, there is a recent survey report issued by one of the leading chartered accountant firm, and they have indicated that there is a there has been an increase of almost 58% in the frauds, and some non-traditional styles of frauds have come up due to technology issues. And you know, this has caused a lot of pain in terms of the overall process of fraud management. The organizations are now looking forward to create a special fraud control units to deal with frauds. There are certain set of frauds which are well known, especially in financial services, but other forms of frauds, like in procurement frauds, data theft frauds, similarly have emerged over a period of time. So things have changed over time, and now the roles of GCs have also taken a different method of dealing with some of these frauds, and how they deal with it, how they deal with stakeholders, how they deal with senior management team, the media management. So in the entire scenario, the GC becomes the main center, and how to manage the entire thing, and give a proper advice for an effective management. To discuss some of these issues and how a GCs play a very pivotal role in having an effective management of fraud risk management, we have our distinguished panel over here, and I welcome them all to the wonderful delegates over here. So I'll start with Mr. Mohit Shukla. And in terms, Mohit, if you see the frauds and the other things which are over appearing, talking about financial services, because you are from financial services, there are various regulatory framework which are available. There are provisions now recently in the Companies Act also have come up, who has defined fraud, and there are regulatory bodies like IRDA, SEBI, RBI who have been. So can you enlighten the participant as to within financial services or otherwise, what are the key regulatory frameworks that deals with overall fraud monitoring, reporting kind of,
Sure, thank you. So I'll basically, I think in the interest of time, focus on perhaps what the banking regulator has in place. So understandably, very concerned about fraud in banks, and also acknowledging the fact that fraud can be of different types. What happens with fraud in banks is that Reserve Bank of India expects, among other things, prompt reporting. They don't expect prompt reporting or any reporting in terms of attempted fraud. But what they want in terms of attempted fraud is that you should have a process in place where that gets discussed at your board level audit committees or the board level or equivalents. But that also then leads to some amount of reporting in terms of consolidated reporting to ensure that the regulators are aware of what happened, what you did, and what are the steps that you took in terms of either mitigating it or enhancing your controls or making them more robust over time to deal with issues of that nature. But in terms of actual reporting, including, but in some ways also acknowledging the fact that it can take time to get to the bottom of a fraud and actually figure out what happened and then come to a conclusion, even taking that into account, they do expect some amount of promptness in terms of when you go to them and what periodicity you then report those issues to the regulator, and also on an ongoing basis, what are the steps that you're taking in respect of those. And interestingly, they also expect that banks do not close or conclude on frauds until every step that is attendant upon that fraud has been completed. So whether it's an investigation, whether it's a reporting to the police, whether the police have completed their own process and then taken steps, everything has to be completed from a regulatory perspective before you can actually declare a fraud as something that's behind you. And then again, to underscore the importance of ongoing awareness and ongoing steps to make your process more robust once you've had a fraud incident is something that they pay a lot of attention to. So it is something that the regulator, for the right reasons, wants to keep banks on their toes on. One interesting aspect of fraud in banks is also when you're dealing with borrowers, then they also expect you to provision for that fraud. In addition to any other steps that you may be taking, you actually end up with a financial impact in terms of what your decision was in terms of a borrowing that then subsequently led to a fraud. And that fraud could be of any nature. It could be that the borrower has given you false security. It could be that they've cooked their books. But if you've been the victim of a fraud,
from a constituent perspective, then it also has a financial impact of this nature on your books in addition to everything else.
Thank you very much, Mohit, on elaborating that. Divya, no, Mohit has touched base on types of fraud and reportings, and one of the issues which the banking sector is facing in terms of security related frauds. Now this leads to the question that, you know, how do you really differentiate between a financial fraud and a non-financial fraud? And there could be a possibility that some of the frauds may not exactly in the nature of financial fraud. Somebody also could be a non-financial fraud, but it leads to a financial loss. Then can you share your experience in terms of, you know, how do you distinguish? And does, as a GCs, dealing with these different kind of frauds needs a different style of strategies dealing with them?
So I'm just going to make it more pragmatic and practical based on the experience that we have recently dealt with in the last 2-3 years. So one of the examples which I'm sure all of you might be facing is a gang of employees. They learn the technology aspect of your company because we are from a technology company, and then they, through their wives or through their family members, form a company and approach these small customers and provide the same services at much discounted rates. And then we come to know that our own business is going by our own employees. How did I deal with this fraud? In a very, very quick manner, we took two of our lawyers to our premises, which is not in Mumbai, but it was in Gujarat. And there, the employees were not aware of anything, what is the plan that we have done. We have kept a newspaper advertisement ready. We have kept all the evidences ready. And then we have called those employees in a chamber. We showed them the evidences and we showed them what is the action we are going to take against them. If they do not understand the implication of this fraud that they have committed on the company, being on the payroll of the company. So number one, they got the message. Number two is they immediately responded with whatever remedy we were seeking from them. We took a disciplinary action against them. And we also dismissed, after following the process, those employees. This is one category of fraud which may not be having an immediate financial impact but is having a large financial impact on the revenues of the company. Another most common fraud, as recently as yesterday and 15 days back, that we in the SMAC, social media, mobility, analytics, and cloud computing, where Internet of Things are the most common things happening with all of us. The email IDs get hacked, the LinkedIn profile get hacked, and we came to know that very gullible, innocent young interns are being offered employment on behalf of my company. And not only offered employment, they have been duped of their own money by the profile of an HR person who has no idea that his own HR profile has got hacked, and third party interns are being given employment offers, and on the basis of the employment offers, they have taken the advance also. So these are the common day happenings which we all are facing. So we should be aware of it and we should know what are the measures that we have to take. And as a GC, based on my learning, I have now placed heavy reliance on the insurance coverages. I have placed heavy reliance on how the communication, culture, compliances need to be kept in strict understanding and communication to employees that what all we are doing to curb these type of practices and be aware. Communication to social media if these things are happening so that people are aware of, and also taking all the necessary legal measures.
Thank you. I think you have touched so many important aspects of... Yeah, go ahead.
Perhaps I can cover off the non-financial fraud as well. So I'm from Nielsen, so we are a big data measurement company. The kind of instances that probably concerns us the most is, you know, instances where there is a arbitrary data interference which possibly impacts the client or the other customer. So when instances of that nature happens, I think there's an extensive review that is obviously needed internally, because obviously there is, you need to assess whether there's a financial loss or something for the external client. And of course you need to understand the motive as well as to why that has happened. But so it's very important that we collaborate well with, of course, security team, which is like probably an equivalent of fraud control team that we have internally. And also I think the reliance on the external counsel is something which I cannot, I really have to underscore the importance of having a good external counsel in such scenarios where you really, really ensure that the extensive review is carried out in terms of what is the extent of damage, what is it that you communicate, because obviously you need to clearly keep in mind that you need to obviously not disclose to another party, right? And that then there flows the question of damages and, how have you like sort of drafted your contract, is there a liability cap and, what is going to happen, in a court scenario, etc. So there's a lot of situations that one needs to anticipate, which I clearly think cannot be done just internally. You really need to place strong reliance on an external counsel as well. Collaborate with different units, ensure that you have the buy-in of your, the finance team, because they obviously need to provision, there are a lot of aspects to be kept in mind. So I just wanted to throw light from a perspective of non-financial fraud, which is in the perspective of our company.
Thank you very much. We spoke about technology and the way things are changing, of course, the social media and all those. So my question is one of them is in terms of how do you think the technology so far has contributed a lot in terms of fraud incidences, and how can technology be used as one of the measures towards fraud prevention? If you can, share some thoughts on that and some examples.
Right. So JLL as an organization has about 10 to 11,000 direct employees and 60,000 vendor employees who are based out from multiple client sites across India. So it makes it all the more challenging for me to catch hold of those people who are committing frauds. And nowadays, most of the companies have lost a huge amount of money because of fraudulent activity by not only its direct employees, but also because of its indirect employees or vendor employees. Now, the role of technology is very important here. And gone are the days, where you used to do the simple audit or simple process gap analysis. Gone are those days. You will not be able to catch, or you will not be able to reach anywhere. So the use of digital forensics or any other kind of technology tool comes into picture. For example, we use a software called as Intella. And how do we use it? For example, let us say some person has committed, we are of the view that some person has committed a fraud. So we fix a bug into his or her system. The system stops. The system goes to the IT department, and through the IT department it comes into us. Once the imaging is done, we do a PST review basis on a keyword, certain keywords, whatever keywords you want to put in, so that automatic review is possible, and you finish it off in a very short span of time. So these are digital forensics and Intellas of the world you can't do without it today. And coupled with this, you have to have this data analytics process in place. Once you have carried out the forensics, you have to have the data analysis in place. So JLL, what we have done is that we have built up three lines of defense. Once we have carried out this review, we built the three lines of defense. One is that you carry out your own process or audit yourself. That is the first line of defense, to see what are the gaps. Your manager can carry out, your senior manager can carry out that analysis. Second is that peer-to-peer review at different sites. For example, one of the sites is in Calcutta, the other site is in Bangalore. So the person from Bangalore will fly down to Calcutta to carry out an audit. Let us say that still you're unsure about the whole thing, then you carry out a third-party audit. So we built in these three lines of defense with the help of technology and with the help of data analytics. We have been successful in catching hold of a lot of people. And we have not only terminated those people who were indulging in fraudulent activities, we have also filed police complaints against them, and not only junior people, even senior people. I mean, the JLL Code of Ethics is very strong, and it gives us the right to terminate people or do anything which is in the interest of the company. But yes, to answer your question specifically, digital forensics, use of Intella, other kind of softwares, couple it with three lines of defense, and you're there.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So Hemant, given your experience, you have worked in multiple organizations, public sector, private sector, and all those. So how do you feel that once these frauds have been finally identified, and when it comes to actioning, and then of course reporting, dealing with police, courts, and judicial authorities, and others. So if you can share some of your experience as a general counsel, what are the specifics we have to keep in mind so that some of these entire process of fraud mitigation or action orientations are well undertaken and they are taken to a logical conclusion. If you can share some of your experience on that.
I hope you will allow me to speak from here. Friends, let me admit that that in last three decades, the role of GC has drastically changed in the positive side, I would say. When I joined in State Bank 85 batch, that time we were just carrying the files. But today, everywhere, whether you are in a public sector or private sector, promoter will firstly call you that you firstly certified this particular statement, particular document, anything. They will call you and ask you to certify. Thereafter, they will sign it. Now, coming to the point, I will just share two interesting episode or the story, the real story of my career and how I have dealt those situations. One is, while I was working as a chief legal advisor in the largest steel sector, one file was sent to us. There is a clear guidelines in the public sector that all high stake value of tender or any contract or even dismissal of high level will go to the chief legal advisor for the approval. So file was sent to me. I saw that one of the company, that company is before the NCLT today, and the promoter are on the bail. So I find that last 5-6 years, a large volume of slag. Slag, when you work in a steel plant, the blast furnace produces slag that is used in cement plant. So I find that last 5-6 years, they have been only competing and getting the tender, and the contract was awarded huge amount of tender. I say, what is this? When I peruse the file, I find that they had formed a beautiful cartel system, that their own sister concern, 4-5 sister concern will apply and two other will apply. And they will put their pricing in such a way that if one fails, other will come into, that will get the award. So I had to give a reporting, and top management was about to issue later, because they were the H1. And the rules say that H1 should be given that one. So we had to send a complete detailed file and reporting system. It was, since it was a public sector, matter was reported to CBO. And they, that time, formulated anti-fraud policy system and how to track such type of cartel system, and also taken the corrective measures. And in that case, some of, unfortunately, the public sector employees were also involved. Now, second is another private sector. While I was working there, mobile tower, that tower has to run throughout the day, 24 hours. So those, they have thousands of towers across the India, pan-India basis. And those tower and remote area, suppose the power is not there, electricity is not there, so they used to provide petrol and diesel for running their generator system. Now, one day it was detected by my promoter that how this the cost of fuel had been increasing for the last 3-4 years drastically. So matter was reported to us that you just investigate the matter. What I did, along with my colleague, one or two colleagues, we visited some of the remote tower area. And we found that the generator is not at all working, whereas the petrol price and the cost of the petrol and diesel, they used to charge from the company. So we had to put up a system, and as a general counsel, we issued charge sheet to, starting from president till the level of DGM. Now here I would caution our general counsel, both in-house, outside counsel. If you know the system, and if you know the department inquiry, then we should conduct ourselves inquiry, suggest the way of inquiry, form, draft the charge sheet. Inquiry proceedings, you have to support the HR department. But by chance, if you do not know, then I would always advise, seek the advice of some expert outside counsel. There is nothing wrong. I don't put the organization in a risk. Because if you are issuing a charge sheet for any such misconduct, it's not easy. You have to conduct inquiry in accordance with the principle of natural justice. And every stage, there is a lot of Supreme Court directions. Even at the last stage, before imposing punishment also, Supreme Court says that you have to issue a so-called notice. That is called second source called notice. So in that organization also, we had dismissed 29 senior executives. And that has given a clear message across the organization that if you commit this type of fraud, the company will not leave you. Over and above, you have also right to lodge FIR with the police station. In that case, we have lodged the FIR. And both department inquiry and criminal proceeding can go parallelly. So as a general counsel, our role is to guide the management if fraud is detected. Don't allow HR department to simply, for the employee, allow them type of culprit or delinquent employee to come and resign and go. Let us guide the management that no. Let us take some action, some serious action, and then take action against those culprits. These are my few thoughts which you would like to just share with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ahmed. Thank you for sharing your experience. So if anybody has any views and they want to get some more detail about the procedure, they can speak to Hemant offline. Divya, Hemant explained quite briefly in terms of the procedural process, briefly in the procedural process. Of course, that will an actioning part. But one of the key issue that as an organization or general counsels that we say is that how to mitigate the financial loss. Of course, the actioning part will be well taken care of through judicial process. But how do we recover those loss which has already happened because of the fraud? And you mentioned in your initial interaction that insurance cover is also one of the areas that we can look at it. So if you can share some of thoughts in terms of what types of insurance covers the companies can take, and as a general counsel, how do you advise to management in terms of types of insurance cover, the extent, the amount, monetary limits, etc., that can be taken as a mitigation strategy to recover against these fraud losses?
So this is a very important learning in my career, and many years back I always used to consider insurance as something not to be completely relied upon, because of the minor small wordings in a huge insurance policy which gives them a escapism mode as to where we are not covered. So that was my foundation years back, but of late there is such a revolutionary change in the insurance undertakers and the types of policy. Before any major sensitive compliance comes like GDPR or crime or technology, the policy with its wide coverage is already there. As a general counsel, I feel we all must take the insurance policies and the requirements based on our company very seriously, and how we can take advantage of insurance by doing the proper notification within the time and also studying what are the parameters where we are covered. For example, frauds are happening in all the companies because of varied reasons. So there is a crime policy which covers extensively not only the employees but also the non-employees. So if an asset has been lost and it's not the loss of that asset is not attributable to your own employees, even that small thing can get covered. So I think the awareness of the insurance is very much a necessary element in our role as a general counsel, not only as general counsel, but earlier we used to shift the insurance responsibility on finance, but it is equally a responsibility of a general counsel within a company. Another thing which, apart from insurance, which I would communicate to all of you as general counsel is internal audit. which is also an important tool to control the and detect the fraud. So when the internal auditor gives its findings, it is not only to be kept in the file, it has to be ensured as a council that all those findings by respective departments are closed. This has a significant impact on diffusing or minimizing the fraud within your organization. And the last thing that I will say, which flows down with all of you, is that as a council, we should ensure that communication is important. So whatever you have felt is important for your organization, it should be communicated properly either through social media or internally to the employees. That also will have a great impact on minimizing the fraud within the organization.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Mohit, just wanted to add what Divya said was that I think it is important for an organization to have a robust risk mitigation program.
Yeah.
Which basically starts from the way you are going to conduct the audit, whether it's internal audit or process gap analysis, have those three lines of defense built in, and whether you want to do it internally, have a peer review, or whatever you want to do, that is the first step. Then you do data analytics. That should be followed. What you rightly said is that the communication has to flow through till the bottom, to all employees, whether you use ethics wallet cards, posters in local language, training during the induction program, signing an undertaking that they will abide by the code of conduct, and following that up with an action plan. So basically, these are various principles of a risk mitigation plan so as to avoid, if not totally eliminate, fraud. You want to add something?
If I may just make one quick point, I think what you rightly allude to is basically the awareness. And every step that you take, first in terms of mitigants and checkpoints, and then the awareness, and then making sure that people are not only aware of what kind of risks the organization is faced, but what the consequences can be, both for people as well as the organization. And part of it also gets covered in terms of the quarterly trainings that people undergo. And most organizations, I think, now mandate that. But I think one very important element for general counsels and legal functions is the element of where and how you get involved. And sometimes I think it becomes important for legal functions to actually intervene to say you need to involve us early when you discover something. Because that's where everything that we've discussed thus far becomes operational and optimally used from a legal perspective. Because unless we know early enough, we will not be able to intervene usefully. And that's why it becomes important that in addition to no surprises for any element of the organization, the legal function needs to get in early to be able to advise you in terms of what you need to do and how you need to do it. You know, interestingly, some of the tools that we now use, technology works both ways. So while people use technology to defraud us, the technology that we use also can sometimes be invasive. So we have to be careful about how we deploy that, what we do with it, and who's doing what with it, and where is that information going. Because like it or not, though we use that for the benefit of the organization, we actually end up potentially infringing somebody's rights as well. So it's when we do that, how do we do that, what do we do with that information, how we treat it, and what confidentiality barriers then get imposed in terms of making sure that the investigation is not tainted or the investigation is not dissipated in any manner also becomes equally important. And then the investigation concludes what kind of report you have, what is it dealing with, what materiality is it surfacing. Absolutely. So everything becomes very important, and that's why I think when we talk about general counsels in the context or legal functions in the context of fraud, we may not have a direct role to play in how it plays out and what the ultimate outcome is, but every step is so fraught with legal implications that it becomes important for us to be involved.
Yeah, I think we all spoke on some of the measures and anti-methods of using fraud control and all those. And I think one point common which is emerging from the discussion is that communication, training and all those. So Sandhya, I think your organization does a lot in this area. You personally have also done a lot of trainings and training in these areas and you know, policies in terms of anti-fraud issues and some of the measures and communication. If you can share some of your methods, like Mohit just said, then you know, how do you do it? So if you can explain some of the things that, you know, practical aspects of how you manage it, probably that will really help.
Sure. So I think my fellow panelists have sort of covered, you know, what are some of the proactive steps one can take. I think it's very important that as a general counsel, I mean, it's pretty much now given that one cannot take your eyes off the ball. So I think, and there's a great deal of responsibility for us to set the tone at the top. So I guess some of the measures that have, you know, worked well for us is we kind of started something called an ambassador program, the integrity ambassador program, where we roped in, you know, people from different functions and then, you know, really made them understand and got them to kind of spread the message. I cannot obviously with certainty say that, oh, look, it's a fantastic success or whatever, but we've seen traction, we've seen people more engaged in the program, we've seen people more buying in terms of how does it practically, you know, affect and impact them from a day-to-day perspective. I mean, things like, I mean, code of conduct everyone has, but just simplifying what the code of conduct means, simplifying what a conflict of interest means, simplifying what, I mean, a violation of conflict of interest, by talking about those examples, talking about what actions have been taken, I think that's a very important role a GC needs to take. You really need to have a, I mean, what I call a deterrent effect. I mean, definitely need to talk about it in the open, encourage your management to talk about it in the open, ensure that you send out communications, like we do things like, you know, integrity newsletters every quarter where we talk about what are the number of, you know, what are the number of cases we've seen, what is it, where is it that we're really seeing the biggest spike in, is it financial fraud, is it data integrity, so that people understand and we actually anonymize the cases and talk about it and really talk about the action, because that is very important. I think a lot of organizations have a culture of, you know, shying away from, I think Tushar and someone mentioned as well, right, I mean, from taking the right action. I mean, if termination is warranted, go ahead, support yourself, arm yourself, but take that action, because the least we can do is to not see the same issue crop up again. I mean, so if you can have a deterrent effect, nothing like it. I think Mohit also spoke about, I mean, you know, the training that you do. One thing that's very relevant is role-based trainings. It's extremely important so that people can understand from the role that they do, how does it impact, you know. I mean, the role-based trainings are very important. I mean, I think things like ethics survey, how much do people understand what these things mean from a, you know, a day-to-day perspective. You know, we take a ethics survey. I think Mohit also covered about, you know, quarterly trainings, code of conduct trainings, which are actually in certain companies truly enforced. I mean, you know, you have to see 100% training. If you're not trained, that's definitely going to impact your, you know, your upgrades or your bonus. I mean, that's the culture one needs to build. Otherwise, a code of conduct will just remain a document, you know, which is just there for, you know, anyone to look at.
For example, the way a particular fraudulent activity gets reported. Now, for example, in JLL, we have anonymous reporting. You can call up a toll-free number and you will not be even asked your name, who you are and where are you from. You can write an anonymous email. Then we have something called as the Ethics Liaison Program. We have mavens sitting here. For example, you have, in your office, you know you have 100 people and you have a Sandhya sitting as a maven, and you can easily walk up to Sandhya and say that, look, I can see some fraudulent activity taking place in the pantry. So, I mean, when you have a person or maven or a liaison officer sitting next to you, I think things become much more easier.
I'm sorry, I actually want to mention, that's a very, very valid point. To have like a very strong whistleblower program, I think is absolutely at the success of, you know, preventing fraud, because people should be able to freely, you know, talk about it. And a lot of companies don't encourage anonymous complaints. I think it's extremely important because sometimes really fearful of coming forward with their identities. So I think it's upon us to investigate based on the evidence they've provided to see if there is any merit in it. There are many instances where you're not able to proceed, but it's extremely important for, you know, companies to encourage. We encourage anonymous complaints as well. So I think, yeah, that's a very valid point. Yes, strong non-retaliation policy. In fact, writing to complainants upfront saying, look, we have a strong non-retaliation policy as well. I think that provides a great deal of comfort as well.
See, role of
role of this is more challenging where you have
three times more than the regular employee. See, those who are on your roll, you can give proper training. And but if you are engaging, say, 4 lakhs, 5 lakhs of contract labor, indirectly or indirectly, they are also your associated with your business. If they commit that type of fraud, because we have come across many such frauds also, how to control those frauds are a challenge for the GC. This is the most important. And therefore, training program and all this whistleblower policy, this policy, we easily can transmit and convey to our regular employee, but how to convey to the, our contract labor, this is also a challenge. And for that matter also, we have conducted many type of the program at the project site. We have invited the contractor, contract labor, that these are the policy, but try to avoid, not to do this type of corrupt practices. And that has given a lot of benefit to our organization.
Thank you. With one question, I mean, as a panel, we covered almost all parts of the investigation, training part, and third party and insurance. One part which is very critical is that when fraud happens, regulators ask a lot of questions, they send a questionnaire, they sometimes also visit your premises. Of course, media come into picture and their certain reports are leaked. Of course, we are not talking about small fraud, but a bigger fraud, something like we have seen recently in the banking system. And in that case, you know, how do you as a GC advise the management or lay down a plan of action? How do you deal with these issues? Okay, one something, the internal inquiry is still going on. There are external consultants who are doing forensic analysis. All those things are still going on. But there's another larger piece, which is, you know, hounding on you, press reports, media, regulators. And that's I feel that as an in-house counsel or GC counsel, that piece becomes quite relevant for you. So how do you advise with them to give a balance and ensure that there is a no loss of confidence by the regulators on the organization while these processes are? If you can show, throw some lights on that, it would be really helpful.
No, absolutely. But I think that's very, very vital. And I think that is a kind of crisis situation where legal functions and GCs become very, very core to the entire holding together. So you have a number of people and obviously all the constituencies are anxious. So the first thing is, of course, nervy. Anxious, upset, and oftentimes not very clear in terms of how they should go about what they want to do. So it becomes, I think, core then to over-communicate. What you have to do basically is then make sure that it centralizes into a core delivery cell. And you, whether you like it or not, do become very, very central to that core delivery cell, because you're basically bouncing off ideas, you basically become a point of reference for other people, because since it is legal, since it has connotations of reputation, regulatory risk, sanctions, media, everything, in terms of being able to frame it such that you hold the reins of how we control the process of communication and step-by-step advancement of the whole process becomes very, very crucial. It is very time-consuming, it can be very nerve-wracking as well. But I think it is a state where you over communicate, where you make sure that you become the repository of information as it flows, and you have to be able to then also make sure that you are, if you're not able to send out a complete response, you basically at least have to reassure the regulatory domain that yes, you're dealing with it, these are the steps you've taken, you will keep them updated as developments take place. It also becomes a situation where you actually are communicating with the regulator maybe twice a day or thrice a day in terms of saying, this is what has happened now, this is going to be done next, this is where we are. Media, in the process, it is always a holding response. It is always reactive. You never go to the media to basically tell them something has happened unless it is something which, of course, you know, has a listing connotation or a listing compliance. But in respect of anything that they get wind of, you react basically with holding responses, and you don't give them a lot of grist to speculate on. So that's also a very, very fine game which you have to play again on the radar, on the ball, just as you would as you're dealing with the regulatory communication.
I think that's a very, very valid point you have made, and I think I'm sure the audiences here will take a lot of points. In fact, I learned a lot also from you mentioned how to deal with that. Divya, now you are also a company secretary there, and in your company, a lot of companies, company secretaries also hold GC role, like you're holding. And in that scenario, you have listing agreement, corporate governance guidelines, and there's a role of board and audit committee also comes into picture. And in fact, one of the terms of reference for audit committee is to deal with fraud risk management and all those. So how what is your take on that, and at what stage the board and the audit committees of the companies needs to be informed? How do you brief them, and how do you kind of insulate the board from these kinds of fraud risk management happens? And as a general counsel, what are your would be advices on that?
I think it's a very relevant topic, because when you are wearing the double hats as a company secretary as well as a general counsel, you get a more broader picture. You are not only the watchguards against any illegal or fraud activities happening within the organization, you are also responsible for taking care of the owners, management, board, stakeholders, everything. So as I have just said in my prior response, that audit committee, internal auditors, they all play a very critical role. And when we are laying down the terms of the reference for the audit committee, and when we are choosing the audit committee members, we are very careful that they are all financial experts, they are having the eligibility criteria, and all the disclosures and reporting are happening very meticulously and regularly. And when these disclosures, reporting, compliances in an organization are met, and internal auditors report, and the minutes are all produced before the audit committee, it becomes very conducive. And one thing which I will again repeat is internal auditor's role in fraud detection is key and critical. And when the report of internal auditor comes before the audit committee, they are to take that report seriously, discuss each and every large, medium and small observations in that report, and they have to ensure that in the next meeting of the audit committee, the compliances arising from the previous internal audit report is placed before the board and met. So all these things are very important in a listed company. And of course, as my friend has spoken about the risk management controls, as a listed entity, all listed entity have to have a risk mitigation policy placed, and it has to be uploaded on the website. So these things are, as a non-listed and a private entity also, as a good practices we all can adopt.
I think one last round of question. Yeah, Hemant, you want to say?
See, the question is that fraud is detected and you have informed all the top authority, your board, everything. But how to punish the culprit, that is the most important job for the GC. And here I would like to share that even if you do not, I am talking about the regular employee, those who do not have service rule, they can also initiate department inquiry under the Constitution of India and also file a criminal case. Both can go parallelly. But those who are associated as a contract labor and you find that he or she has committed fraud, then you can only invoke criminal case, not department inquiry, because he is not your employee. So these two actions should be taken, and as a GC you have to take it to the logical end, that you complete the inquiry within time bound period, appoint a good inquiry officer, and if you have filed the charge sheet with the police station, you ensure that the culprit is punished. That these are the important role of the GC in the current scenario. Thank you.
One last question. I mean, though no doubt the way we have explained the various aspects as a GC to work on. One last question, starting on Tushar. As a GC, how do you ensure that there's a, you work very closely, analyze and see all the functions work together? Your quick take on it, we'll just take up similar round.
So basically, can you repeat the question?
Yeah, as a GC, how you ensure that there's a complete licensing, all the functions like fraud team, internal audit team, if you have HR team, they work all closely in terms of ensuring that there's a anti-fraud management culture is very much embedded in the organization. Your quick takes on that.
Right, so basically, you have to ensure that you work as a team. You can't work in isolation in today's world. For example, if you're dealing with a financial fraud, you have to be in touch with finance. So far as action taken is concerned, or action to be taken is concerned, that once we recommend to the management that this is the action that is to be taken, if it is, that is a termination, so then it directly goes into the HR, we liaise with HR. If investigation comes under me directly, so I hit the investigations as well, because, I mean, like I said, we use all those tools and all. So investigation, we carry, the legal carries out investigation, then goes into HR, and along with finance, we also see whether there's a financial possibility of a financial loss at a client side. Along with that, also to have a chat with finance on the insurance bit, if there is a likelihood of professional indemnity claim being raised against us. So in one of the cases, I cannot name the client, is that, you know, we were rendering transportation services, housekeeping, cafeteria, electrical services, and all the stuff. We found out that everybody, all including the managers, including the finance manager sitting there, were involved in fraudulent activity right from top to bottom. So what we did was, like, you know, we obviously used the services of a third party, carried out forensics, did market intelligence on them, and ultimately terminated them. Through continuous interaction with HR, finance, and auditors.
So very, very well, Pandan, we have to work together. Your take on that, Sandhya, how can you, can you know, implement that?
So I think the role has kind of shifted from being reactive to being, you know, proactive. I think what one needs to see is how can you make use of all the data that you have to ensure that it doesn't happen in the future. So I guess, I think Tushar rightly mentioned, your collaboration with some of these functions are very important. But what also works well is to have like a cross-departmental, you know, risk committee of sorts, you know, to basically talk about what are the trends that you've seen, and, you know, work very closely with functions like security to ensure that, you know, the recommendations are first of all put through, but then get the buy-in from the other functions to ensure that it's implemented. I think the role of legal just doesn't end by, you know, saying that, by providing a sermon saying these are the, you know, implementations or whatever. I think the proactive role one needs to take is to also ensure that we follow through. I think that's when one can really kind of, you know.
So work together, do a proactive role. Hemant, your thoughts on that? Anything, you know, as a GC, you know.
I agree with my other co-panelists that GC has to work as a team. And for that matter, I would say that audit department, HR department are very important. So all has to work together and then take a corrective measures. Not only take a particular case of fraud, but what learning you have in going through the detail of the matter, then how you will improve your system for future, those corrective measures should also be implemented in the organization.
So work together, being proactive, implement corrective measures. Any thoughts from you, Mohit, on that?
No, just one, that the more complex your structure, the more risk there is that sometimes you probably may not be in the center of what's happening and at the right time. So I think it's very essential, you know, from a committee point of view, from a discussion point of view, from a collaborative point of view, and making sure that people understand that if there is something that is complicated or complex, they need to come to you, becomes very, very critical. Because all said and done, from a legalities perspective, from a complexity perspective, I don't think there's anything, any function better equipped to deal with it than the legal function. So bringing it together becomes very important.
Your last thoughts, anything on, as a GC, anything what we can contribute on those? Anything, we just want to round up this session?
I shared all my thoughts on that.
But
if there are any specific questions,
I'm okay. So that ends this session, and thank you, my panelist member here, for sharing their thoughts and experience. Now I'm opening the floor for the questions. If any questions, as the panel is happy to take. Yeah, Pulin. So Pulin has some questions. We have a mic, please.
My name is Pulin Kumar. I am from Adidas. My question, it's not question, but we have heard about the entire gamut of the, you know, control in an organization depends upon three pillars. That is prevent, detect, and consequence management. We have heard on all the topics from the esteemed panelists. But my take on the entire issue is that we should work more and more on the prevent option, because this is the pillar where we can prevent all those things from happening, we should not even go to the consequence management. If it is a fait accompli, we have to handle that. That's another issue. But being in corporate, the most important role of a GC is to work on prevent management, prevent pillar, and of course, as Mohit said, touched upon the collaborative approach. That's mostly that is required to work as a collaborative environment. Collaborate with other teams, other people, other verticals, and see how preventive steps can be taken. So that's kind of the most important role, rather than going into the detect and consequence management. So obviously those can be eliminated as long as we work more and more on the prevent management.
Yeah, so prevention is better than cure, something else.
Absolutely. And yeah. I just agree with that completely. Preventative steps are something that are so vital. But it's interesting. I'll just give you a small example. Printers are programmed to detect, right? And they're designed to detect because it's a preventative step. So if somebody has resigned and is going somewhere, competition maybe, and you suddenly find a flurry of printing activity, it gets caught.
In fact, what we should do is that what we don't do is that we're not able to do it, and we have not been able to implement successfully is a rotation policy. For example, we service various clients at various sites. I'm not able to transfer that particular employee from one site to the other. It's a standard audit requirement. We're not able to do that successfully. For example, I can't transfer a person sitting in Hyderabad to Gurgaon. And even sometimes, even the clients don't allow that.
I think in the interest of time, we are done with that. And so if any further questions there, we can take offline. We have an hour of break after that. So on behalf of my panel, I thank the audience over here and also my co-panelists for enlightening their thoughts and views. And we really had a very interactive session. So thank you very much, Tushar, Sandhya, Himan, Mohit. Thank you very much.
Thanks to Mohit. Thanks to Ambar and his wonderful team. I think this was a very insightful session, but then there's one thing called lunch, and the thought of food now overtakes the food for thought. So I wish we could give you some more time in a very engrossing session. Thank you very much, panelists. May I request Ravleen to come over, please, and may I request Ambar to hand over small mementos to fellow panelists, please, starting with Madam Divya. Thank you, ma'am, for being here. Thanks, Sandeep. Next.
Doubling on the applause, please.
Yeah. Thank you, Hemant, sir. Thank you, Sandhya. Thank you, Mr. Chawla. Thanks, indeed. And may I call Zameer on stage, please, to hand over a memento to Ambar. Thank you, Zameer. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, before we split for lunch, let's celebrate a very happy occasion. One of our delegates celebrates her birthday today. Can we have Vinakshi on stage, please? A very leading Supreme Court lawyer. She's come down all the way from Delhi. So happy birthday, Vinakshi. So can we have the cake, please? It just occurred to us that it's her birthday today.
Hi, all. I, Vinakshi Kadan, I practice in Supreme Court as an advocate, and we run a law firm called Trustman & Co. And I'm Secretary General's wife, Kaviraj Singh. I represent INBA as a senior advisor as well. And just quick 5 minutes before the ladies leave, or some of us might just split after lunch. But we want you all here, but just a request to, especially the ladies, I want you all to just kindly open up your kit and see. One, there's a membership form, Indian National Bar Association membership forms. Kindly fill up the form and leave it at the reception. We have the people sitting there who can take care of it, and we just courier out the ID cards to all present here. Number two, we are running a sexual harassment survey, INBA's initiative for women. So I need the support, especially from, I already spoke to ma'am here, and just a brief on that, the survey is up on site, it's for the, especially for the women victims. And all those who have witnessed also can, you know, just go ahead and fill up the survey. The book is going to be launched on the second survey. The first survey have happened last year in 2017. And another phase wherein I want a support from you all. We are very soon going to be launching another book, that's Phenomenal She. We launched it on last year on Women's Day with the UN, and we had very good profiles. So anybody who wants to nominate any women, so again it's going to happen in March, but the link is going to be uploaded on site. So anybody whom you think has done some work in the area where